You are now listening to the number one podcast in Sabah.
I was going to rip his heart out. I'm the best ever. I'm the most brutal and vicious and most ruthless champion there's ever been. There's no one to stop me. Praise be to Allah.
Coming to you live from Sabah. This is Kinabalu Podcast.
Baik, podcast ini dibawakan khas kepada anda oleh the third Global Agritech Summit 2024. Come and join us this upcoming 8th and the 9th of October at Sabah International Convention Center, SICC, for an amazing event in celebrations with the future of agriculture. Di sini, Global Agritech 2024 ini, ataupun Gates, akan memberikan anda all scope of angles to upscale opportunities in the future of making the agriculture more profitable, more productive, more sustainable, and to the era of the
modernization
sesuai mengikut cabang bidang perdagangan anda.
Bukan itu saja. Di sepanjang dua hari ini kita akan dihujani dengan conference, Q&A sessions, bual bicara daripada panel-panel terkemuka negara, khas buat hadirin dan hadirat yang hadir. Betul. Tidak lupa juga kita ada booth-booth yang padat dengan pameran serta knowledge yang tersedia oleh para peserta pameran di Gates 2024 yang ada berjumlah 80 yang kita dengarlah. Ya, selain itu juga kita ada showcase demonstrasi dan peluang meluaskan networking kita antara satu pengusaha ke pengusaha yang lain.
Betul.
Jadi jangan lepaskan peluang ini dengan mendaftar penyertaan anda sekarang juga.
Yep.
Dan untuk mengetahui lebih lanjut lagi, terus saja layari www.globalagritechsummit.com atau email mereka di info@globalagritechsummit.com, dan anda juga boleh direct WhatsApp mereka di 012-335-5067.
Kita panggil
Kihoi.
Listen up, it's time to get the word out. Kinabalu Podcast is what it's about. Hear the stories, hear the beats. Listen to the podcast, it's sure to please. Kinabalu Podcast is the one to hear. It's full of stories, music and chant. So turn it up and listen loud. This podcast is sure to make you proud. It's the hottest podcast around. It's sure to make your feet move to the sound. It's the perfect way to pass the time. So turn it up and get in the groove and rhyme. Kinabalu Podcast is the one to hear. It's full of stories, music and chant. So turn it up and listen loud. This podcast is sure to make you proud. The stories are inspiring and the music is great. It's sure to make you stay up late. So don't be shy, check it out. This podcast is sure to make you shout. Kinabalu Podcast is the one to hear.
Yo.
Selamat kembali ke Kinabalu Podcast. Saya Ricardo.
Saya Kenny.
The number one podcast in Sabah.
Super legit.
And kami masih lagi ingin mempromosikan Gates 2024 ataupun Global Agritech Summit
2024
yang akan berlangsung di SICC 8 dan juga 9 hari bulan nanti Oktober.
Yeah man, sebulan lagi.
Untuk mengetahui lebih lanjut, boleh pergi product talk kami, dan seperti yang kami cakap di intro kami tadi, ada detail-detail di sini. Itulah nanti di posting kami, di tutorial kami akan ada jugalah.
Oh.
Well, producer ada bagi kita subject actually.
What is it? Macam your, suspense.
Your most traumatized events that have occurs or happened to you your lifetime as in for now.
Up till now lah.
Yeah,
up till for now. As long as we lived.
Yeah. I'm going to start first.
You go ahead, man.
My first one is kita ada banyak traumatized event ataupun yang kita tidak dapat lupa lah. First is the passing of my dad. That particular event, I may say tiada satu orang pun yang pernah mau bersiap sedia untuk kehilangan kau punya bapa. So up until now saya masih tidak percaya yang my father gone, man. So saya masih tengyang-nyang suara dia. Saya merindukan dia punya nasihat-nasihat. And how dia raised us. And I think tiada siapa yang pernah mau bersiap sedia untuk kehilangan parents ataupun seorang ayah. Kita tidak mau imagine pun how.
Yeah, man.
Actually, so that is one of my most traumatized. Yang aku trauma kenapa? Masa start kena masuk dalam, you know, keranda.
Shit.
And keranda kena bawa balik pergi hutan perudu daripada Queen Elizabeth. And then
dapat bila saya sampai tu kan, di rumah. Saya stay for I think for the last 5 to 10 minutes to stuck di pintu. Because sekujur tubuh yang dulu saya sayang, yang saya anggap safe space for me, sudah tiada dan sudah kaku di situ. So saya trauma tu event because of saya tidak dapat terima. Even though dia sakit quite fast, quite rapid. Get to know dia ada cancer pun December. Kita acknowledge dia ada batuk berdarah, I think September 2013, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah. And then 2014 he passed on, which is April. And sangat cepat, kau tengok beza dia berapa bulan saja. So during that time dia buat lobectomy, which is to remove one of the lung. So sini kita kanan ni ada dua, di sini ada tiga part. So one of the lung yang di atas tu remove entirely. It's like defying the power of God. Of course, like it's technology, it's science and all.
It's medical science.
Medical stuff and all. But the person yang I don't know what happened because in the same ward ada dua katil saja. And sebelah dia tu uncle ni. Same age as my dad. Same year. Same birthday.
My goodness.
Yeah, same date.
Coincidence.
11 hari bulan November, 11-11. Dia pun 11-11. Same year as my dad.
My goodness.
And also same penyakit, lung cancer. The difference is my dad tidak smoke.
Okay.
Tapi dia memang heavy smoker.
Okay.
So probably he got it from there. Masa buat, what do you call that? Mau ambil the sample tu, what do you call that?
I don't know.
Yeah, there's a term lah. Dia buat untuk ambil to get to know whether it's cancer or not. Actually twice orang pernah buat. Sebab satu tu tidak berapa clear. So the process yang membuatkan dia sebenarnya prolong. The third one untuk lobectomy tu, he didn't sign it, the friend. Dia tidak sign, my dad sign. So my dad went on for the surgery to remove the one of the lung punya part.
Right.
He didn't. He survived for many years. He died eventually, but not because of cancer. He was cancer free. He was on first stage, I think third stage juga.
Oh,
as my dad. Yeah.
Oh, that's wow.
He passed on because of dia ada because of that dia sudah antibody dia sudah tak kuat. So whatever comes in boleh buat penyakit dia sangat cepat merebak. Dia actually macam ada infection di pernafasan ke begitu sih.
Oh, respiratory infection itu.
I think to do with dia punya lung.
Okay, it's something to do with dia punya chemotherapy and all that. It reduces dia punya.
He didn't go for chemo pun.
No pun lah.
No.
I see.
He go for organic way of healing. Which is
chemotherapy lah.
Yeah, chemotherapy.
If it's correct.
Yeah, which is dia consume banyak air, dia avoid, dia avoid outdoor activities. Dia pakai mask kalau di mana-mana dia pergi. Dia tidak pergi banyak tempat yang panas, because itu boleh sparks the cancer cells.
Yeah.
Dia tidak makan gula, which is sparks the cancer cells juga, dan tidak makan minyak. And also dia ada, I don't know whether it's true or not, allegedly the Kangen water.
Right.
So he consume that, and also dia buat almost daily buat the you know, daripada belakang masuk belakang tu, push it in water, lepas tu flush it out.
So
colon muka sikit in the colon, sort of like that.
Or something, I forgot the term, but it's colon flushing, like you kasih bersih usus.
Usus ya. Hey, got free. So unfortunately my dad pula pass away months, I think a few months after that. So I was traumatized by seeing the part of the the lung. Because we got sources lah. Ada nama ada saudara kerja di dalam. Dia even kasih gambar lagi. As big as your palm, bisa dia taruh in a plastic bag. By right, when you got cancer, kau nak beli sakit dan luka. Jangan bilang di luar, yang external ni, apalagi yang internal. So di dalam tu untuk dia baik. Sudahlah, kau dah cancer, kau mau fight lagi, but actually he's already spread out to the lymph nodes.
Oh my goodness.
So kalau dorong cakap tu sudah fourth stage, kalau sudah pergi lymph nodes, which is these nodes ni, these lymph nodes ni sudah connected to all of the parts of the body. Tapi the Uncle Christie, I say the name is Uncle Christie, dia female name, tapi Uncle Christie, he survived for many years. So man, that is one of my traumatized event lah.
Dude, I'm very sorry to hear this, man. I know you've talked about this for, you know, quite some time. We know each other for a long time, but we know how you feel, man.
Let me ask you, have you ever imagined how your father gonna pass on?
No, man.
I want to get ready, macam apa should I do, you know?
I've accepted the fact that you will never get ready for someone's death.
No, man, no,
never,
man.
Even for myself, this is just to say, yang, you know, you're not ready for anybody's death, man. Like for my nenek, my beloved dudu, which is one of the reason why I've been staying in camp for so long, up until 2022, I think. Who built a house? This studio that we're in is actually for her, actually. Now that she's passed on, we are converting it something else, but that's beside the point. We will never get ready for her passing, and especially
in someone very close to you.
Yeah, in the later stages in life, you know, we've been providing this and that. I've been going to Beaufort, back here, bringing medication, my mom did everything that she did, she could. She told me that, you know, she's already ready, but you know that they are not ready.
Yeah, man.
We're not ready as well. So when they pass, they'll just go without you. That's the thing.
Yeah.
And I definitely won't be able to feel what you feel, man. I can only empathize, and that's not enough. I would never imagine how it will be like losing my own father or my mother. Yeah, definitely won't.
Well, another event.
Yeah. This is your second traumatizing experience. Go ahead, man.
Is during the labor of my first child, ataupun Ingrid.
Nana.
Yeah. Because me and Nat, kita ada miscarriage 2 times.
I see.
And then the possibility is very odd. And also at the same time, the level of dangerousness is
the
actually,
risk is very high.
And saya cuti almost a month plus, and I don't care about anything else to make sure the labor going smoothly lah.
Yeah, man, family come first.
Yeah,
man.
So
definitely.
I left everything in game. I stayed in KK during dia punya trimester, third trimester yang doing labor sudah. 2 weeks before saya sudah standby pergi sana. And then we thought it's just like that. But apparently my wife, dia kena tahan lagi.
Oh,
masuk pergi the internal care unit lagi, which is dia pendarahan yang sangat teruk.
My goodness.
Dia setting dia pun sudah, muka dia pun sudah lemah habis, weak, pale and everything. Dia tidak selera mau makan. Even though dia banyak macam order, saya pergi beli apa semua, dia tidak makan. Then I thought 2-3 days. 7 days. Rupanya 7 days that long. And I remember the doctor call me apa yang macam, okay, kau boleh, kami daripada hospital, dia cakap, boleh bawa balik the uri, kata dia bilang, to the hospital. Masa tu saya sudah sama-sama icebox.
The uri
the fridge. It's in the saki-baki from the birth. Kalau okay. bagi birth ada yang macam dia punya
placenta,
placenta and all that. Terbunik lah kita panggil kan.
Alright,
So they know the parts yang kalau dia sudah keluar, so long bilang macam ada tertinggal dalam lagi. So I said, saya sudah masuk dalam fridge nih, because I want to bring back, mau tanam di sinilah. Kota Marudu. Then saya prepare lah balik, kasih keluar. Then dia call balik, oh no need. Kita ada buat diorang they took picture. From second diorang ada make records. Then okay that's good. Tapi when I hold it, it's actually parts of your baby, part of my wife at the same time is there. And dia bertarung nyawa To give birth to Nana. And you know what I do, what I did. I actually stayed di kereta. Padahal saya boleh balik pun. I stayed not that far pun daripada UCA pergi Likas, hospital Likas. We did actually ask around, did our research to apa ni, pergi yang private. Then some of my family members, ada kawan pada family members yang nurse and all, bilang if ada complication kan di private, diorang akan hantar pergi government punya hospital juga. Dia bilang they will come here tu,
because
diorang dah cukup equipment and all.
Okay,
so come to think of it, to pay we don't mind. Memang kami ready sudah. Sudah bayar. Adalah ada beberapa tempat yang kami sudah, ada yang 5,000, 7,000, ada yang 12,000, up to 15,000 pun ada. Macam Glen Eagles and all. But then out of that, saya free. Saya tidak bayar apa-apa pun sama government sebut.
You got GL and all that.
So my wife entitled. But not to put it aside. During that time, out of that 7 days,
right,
it's actually prior to before that pun saya sudah stay, because kami pergi lepas tu dah jadi, you know. Kami pergi tapi belum ada bukaan and all. So saya tengok memang sihat, memang dia sangat-sangat penat, sangat-sangat in a very
weak stage.
And I cannot see her begitu. Dia baring, dia angkat Nana pergi sebelah, dia terpaksa berdiri duduk luar pergi pusing pergi sebelah. Saya on standby. One time I was doing my recording di sana, you see, just to kill the time. My suddenly Ned come. She came and it's time, dia bilang. Dia tunjuk tangan, dia berdarah sudah. So pulang rambut, pergi hospital apa semua.
Okay.
Then sebab kami pergi 2 nights in a row, dia sudah kesakitan tapi belum lagi doktor suruh balik.
Okay.
Doktor suruh balik, which is we understand lah juga. Orang pun banyak beranak apa semua sana kan. Bersalin lah. Then masa berdarah sudah, kami pergi. So okay, doktor bilang okay sudah, dia bilang okay this time. So they stay, I think from mistaken, one night daripada tu petang tu sampai besok dia subuh baru dia dapat. So dia mengerang kesakitan and all, menunggu tu masa. I'm not saying yang saya punya teruk, orang lain pun sama juga, but my experience lah. Then saya tengok dok, my mom, dia nangis sudah kesakitan apa semua. I cannot bear to see. I was so traumatized by that. And what I did, saya stay sana malam tu, saya tidur di kereta. Saya tahu if anything just let me know, I'm just a few steps away. So I do best part. Masa saya parking, cari tempat saya untuk saya mau rehat, tidur apa semua, saya punya bekal ada sudah. I got my Netflix on, ada sudah everything. I thought only me, rupanya ramai laki-laki, husband-husband yang stay di sana. So kami becomes friend, bercerita-cerita gini. Ya macam perkampungan sudah sana, waiting for dia punya. Cuma saya, people kami go lah, sebab orang satu malam, dua malam. Saya 7 malam.
Oh yeah, to stay there. Kau jadi ketua kampung lah.
And then pagi I go buy breakfast dulu, baru antar dia, baru saya balik rumah. Because bukan masa melawat kan. Balik rumah, saya tidur, nap, tunggu sampai pukul 2. Then saya pergi lagi. Ada time masa melawat, 12 ke 2 lah tu. Masa melawat,
I see. Lepas
tu saya bagi makan, supply makan and all. Then talking back masa labor tu, that the miss half an hour, so actually I want to go in. I want to experience myself lah. But saya termiss one, saya tertidur di kereta. Sekali dia cakap, I'm going in, dia bilang. So saya termiss tu, saya dah dapat sign tu untuk join in masuk.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. Then I also, I'm up until now, I still, I also don't know how brave I am I gonna be, you know,
if that
happens, it's gonna again. Happen lah. Mm-hmm. Then saya tunggu, cuma dia kena tahan lama. It was actually sudah pukul, I think around 1:02 or 1:03.
Morning.
No, dia pelayan pukul 4 begitu. Up to during mau pagi-pagi sudah 6 o'clock begitu. Tapi dia kena tahan sampai pukul 2:03 begitu.
Oh my goodness.
Because of that lah, complication, you know, because of perdarahan apa semua. I happen to see my baby, I think sudah pukul 2:03 begitu. Then kena hantar pergi the ward. Saya kasih azan apa semua. Then it is like macam, wow, I'm a father now. After 5 years kami got nobody. And saya tengok, saya ingat sinat boleh balik, saya teruskan. Lepas tu kebanyakan orang terus balikkan.
Yeah.
Another 5 more days after that. So I was so traumatized because seeing her begitu give birth.
Right.
And then belabor apa semua. Saya rasa macam many people, I have to say, many husbands out there terlupa pasal ni benda when they want to mess around. You know, scandal here and there makes it, they forgot yang dirong punya wife ni actually bertarung nyawa to give birth to your children, to your child. So I think husband out there, you need to remember this and remember this clearly. Sebab ada orang out of 10, ada yang 1 or 2 actually passed on. Some ada together with the baby, or the baby safe and the wife passed on. Because of mengerang terlalu lama, habis tenaga apa semua, memang ditakdirkan untuk pergi.
The risk is always there.
Saya pun sangat risau masa itu, my first experience and all. Dan saya betul-betul berdoa banyak kali apa semua, saya risau. So for me, these two events, it's the two events yang betul-betul traumatize me up until now. So itulah orang cakap, jadi bila lagi ada anak lagi, you know, it's actually, it's not easy. Sinet pun macam, I don't know how I can bear this anymore, you know. So kami ada 3 kan. So I say salute orang-orang yang lama lah. Yang macam kami ada 6 orang adik-beradik, my mom. And my banyak lah family kita close, you know. Kau ada 2 kan. Adik-beradik. But you know, kadang-kadang rezeki. Good thing banyak anak beradik, ada banyak adik-beradik. And nothing, these two events memang
traumatizing.
Traumatizing for me lah.
Does it change your life? Made you into a better person, a stronger person?
For sure, frankly speaking, kami daripada background dusun, which is a minority of Muslim. Saya tidak belajar agama dan macam juga last time.
I see.
Saya bukan berbangga dengan itu. Saya tidak sembahyang, sembahyang kadang-kadang, hari Jumaat, hari raya, you know. Because my dad is from pagan. My mom pula from an SDA. So dulu-dulu bukan ada sumber macam dari YouTube. Bukan ada banyak ustaz roaming around yang you can go to. And masih ada that stigma yang kalau kau sudah lewat, malu sudah kau mau belajar bah. Gitu kan. So kami faham. And kami punya job is to learn. Yet my zaman pun still masih begitu. Katakan kau tidak pandai membaca, kau tidak pandai sembahyang gitu. So masa my dad coma for 5 days, I said I have tried everything. So saya nak mau my dad happen ni, dia meninggal ni, saya tidak buat apa-apa. Apa lagi semua buat ni? We have tried all. Kami pergi jumpa the Shifa punya doktor, yang perubatan Shifa dari segi Islam. Jumpa doktor sana, specialist sana sini. Yet saya nak tahu selama bagaimana. Then I said tiada lagi. Yang bagi kau nyawa is God. Yang tarik nyawa kau pun is God.
God also.
I said I have to go back there. So I started learning. online saya baca macam mana mau sembahyang balik ni, refresh back, macam mana mau ambil wuduk ni, macam mana actually mau baca itu, baca ini, what kind of doa. And apparently right after that saya betul-betul transform myself to really want to learn. So I think for the past 1 to 2 years after that, saya betul-betul belajar. Every night saya baca Yasin, every night toh. Kalau saya tinggal satu, saya akan baca dua kali in the second night, which is tidak perlu pun kau buat gitu, but I just my willing to do lah. And
which is good.
So I learn a lot daripada Muslim punya punya perspective ataupun punya knowledge because of my dad punya apa yang berlaku tu my dad. Which is as a man, as a he's gonna be like orang bilang imam to the family. You should know that. And my wife pula, it makes me more responsible. My high sense of responsibility. I have to be more calmer, not macam dulu baran and all. I have to, kau boleh handle orang, mungkin kau boleh baran orang, tapi anak kau nak boleh baran. Things yang dia sepatutnya dah buat, kau dia buat tapi you need to,
you know,
understand.
Be patient
and all. So it changed me, transformed me to what I am now. I'm not saying I'm good, perfect, but better me. So I think these events yang whatever we've been through, banyak we've been through. Kita pernah yang macam, oh shit, saya mau kena kejar duit sudah, kereta mau kena tarik apa semua. Itu event-event yang memang semua pun berlaku. But these two events memang really put something I cannot forget.
Nothing compares to that too.
Yeah. Adalah banyak-banyak apa semua, but memang stick to my heart till I die lah.
Damn, man.
How about you, man?
Well, for me, you know, you...
Oh, let me just finish this.
Yeah, go ahead, man.
The loss of our house.
That's the third one, yes.
Yeah, that's the third one.
My God.
I thought I'm a very manly that time. I thought I'm brave enough to brave the rain lah, orang bilang. Masa di Singapore, I was like, okay, sudah takdir ni. What else to do? Yang penting tiada nyawa yang terlibat, apa semua, kami semua selamat. Then I'm okay. With the help from surrounding kawan-kawan di sini, di Singapore, overwhelming. I'm just don't know what to say. Thank you so much.
Absolutely grateful.
And so bila sampai Kiki jumpa my in-law, because she was there. She was inside the house.
Yeah, I was there at the end, the aftermath.
Yeah, you were there. Video call was there, you know. And dia nak nangis, suruh jumpa kami apa semua. Sorry doh, mami tak dapat kasih selamat. I said, sorry doh, kami tak dapat selamat. I said, no, kamu selamat pun sudah cukup. It's okay. Rumah tu boleh buat balik. I was like doing, you know, this encouraging my own self, by the way. and then
self-motivating.
Sampai okay, the next day balik kota Bandung. Saya limas depan.
Oh man.
Saya parking di garage. Seeing there's no more garage, man. And looking at my house, saya kat arena and my teardrops turun looking at my house.
Shit, man.
It's all ground, man. It oh shit, man.
Okay, man.
Saya tengok the studio is gone.
Yeah.
The equipment is gone. Saya tengok this is the place where I gonna, you know, we're gonna grow up there. Gonna grow old there. My children's gonna grow up there. No more. All the tiles are gone. Are popped out.
Cracked up, man.
Yeah. There's no more kitchen, there's no more TV. Done. So because I work my ass off on that. We work on our ass off on that to build the house yang kita akan okay slowly make sure everything's perfect. Nanti next kita buat pagar, kita kena kasih simen sini. There's no more, man. So saya
all the plans that, you know, we talked about juga, that you guys have planned. Oh my God. I remember that day yang I think it's exactly that day yang kau balik tu, that night saya balik Johan.
Yeah.
I pergi tempat the big house tu.
Yeah.
Oh shit, man.
Saya muntah aku tu. I cannot control myself. Macam ada something yang I cannot accept. I thought I'm strong to face my own house that time. Saya muntah-muntah. My mom kasih sabar. My net pun, si net peluk saya. Dia pun nangis. Saya pun macam, oh man, I got no more house to go back or whatever got left in my luggage. That was the only things that left. Yeah. Yang saya ada, and my wife ada, anak ada.
Sorry, man.
And then I rebuilt from whatever I got from there.
Yeah.
People are seeing from the podcast, from everybody, that it's like I'm okay. But actually, deep down inside, shit, it is the hardest and traumatized event that I have to face. Losing my house. I miss my house. My wife miss my house. Even though my daughter pun nimbas kan, Nana house burn. I want to go back there. I miss Nana house. Saya pun macam, shit, man. Tapi itulah, saya accept takdiran. Saya redo. So, my God, I work hard. I work my ass off so hard. I go to the event, which is macam, fuck brand awareness, man. Memang, but actually, I'm looking for to rebuild the house and to rebuild ourselves. So, saya
hustle lah.
Hustle often.
Yeah.
Saya bagi net to cure her. This is for you. I said, give her 20,000 more than that actually. I said, buy whatever you want to buy for the house. Kami pergi rental house. We stayed in the homestay for I think a month plus.
Yeah.
Here and there. And then kami sewa rumah up until now. Up until now belum to rebuild the house, but we rebuild ourselves lah.
That's
the most important thing.
Yeah, man.
There's something for you to go back to. To eat, to shade, and to, you know, to rebuild spiritually, externally, and we keep on doing our podcast and all.
Yeah, man.
And I'm in safe ground as long my family is there. My wife, my daughter, anak-anak ada. My family from Selaping, my family from Tawau is there. I'm okay. My friends around me are good, so I'm okay, I think. But we are still doing our best to rebuild the house. And yeah, that is one of my traumatized event that I cannot forget. This three lah. Losing of my dad. The birth of my daughter Ingrid. And the losing of our house to ground zero.
Yeah, man. People say, you know, more like a consolation word for you and your family. As long as your family is safe and you're together, anywhere that you go is your home.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, man. Shit, man. I personally, coming from me, when it comes to your third traumatizing event, I was there with you.
You traumatized yourself watching that, experiencing that.
Right? It was burnt to the ground in front of me. I couldn't do anything. But I'm glad your extended family is safe. Yeah. Woman to I safe, and Alif, he's the hero.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, he's the hero. And
kau bayangkan kalau dia tiada, to run off and to tell everybody, to sambut my grandma.
Yeah.
I mean his grandma.
Yeah.
Which is my in-law, my mother-in-law.
Yeah.
Lompat daripada jendela.
Yeah. Crazy. Well,
we are flying to Kuala Lumpur to talk about gates, the event that you guys should go, especially for your Saban, even though you're from Peninsula or from Singapore, for neighboring countries, come over to gates. We're gonna fly to KL to speak with Mr. Dylan.
Yeah, man.
Here you go. Let's go.
Hi everyone, I'm Boss James. You are listening to Kinabalu Podcast, number one podcast in Sabah.
Baik, podcast ini dibawakan khas kepada anda oleh the third Global Agritech Summit 2024. Come and join us at this upcoming 8th and the 9th of October at Sabah International Convention Center at SICC for an amazing event and a celebration with the future of agriculture. Di sini ni, di Global Agritech 2024 akan memberikan anda all scopes of angles to upscale opportunities in the future of making agriculture more profitable, more productive, more sustainable to the era of modernization sesuai mengikut cabang bidang peladangan anda.
Bukan itu sahaja, di sepanjang dua hari ini kita akan dihujani dengan conference, Q&A sessions, bual bicara daripada panel-panel terkemuka negara khas buat hadirin dan hadirat yang hadir. Tidak lupa juga kita ada booth-booth yang padat dengan pameran serta knowledge yang tersedia oleh para peserta pameran di Gates 2024. Selain itu juga kita ada showcase, demonstrasi dan peluang meluaskan networking kita antara satu pengusaha ke pengusaha yang lain.
Yep.
Jangan lepaskan peluang ini dengan mendaftar penyertaan anda sekarang. So untuk mengetahui lebih lanjut lagi, terus saja layari www.globalagritechsummit.com atau email mereka di info@globalagritechsummit.com, dan anda juga boleh direct WhatsApp mereka di 012-335-5067.
Ya, kita masih lagi bersama dengan Mr. Dylan. For your information, Mr. Dylan, we are having quite a heavy storm right now outside the studio. But anyway, I want to ask you, Mr. Dylan, are you like macam in this agriculture, are you actually from the background probably?
Well, to be frank, of course, you know, this generation yang, I think mungkin the 80s generation were more into, you know, work force and everything. So, agriculture ni kalau nak kata tak ada, tu tak adalah. Of course, came from the background of kampung, you know.
Yeah,
you know,
I see.
Exactly, you know? So, kita ada. Bukan kata knowledge terlalu mendalam, tapi serba sedikit tu kita tahulah.
I see.
You know, kita balik kampung, you know, rumah atuk, rumah nenek.
Where you from?
So, you know, I'm from Perak.
Perak,
I'm
from Perak. Perak?
Yeah. Slim River.
Slim River.
Slim River is my kampung, yeah.
Is it true that they told us river there are all slim?
Dia nama saja Slim River tu slim, tapi
dia kira river tu gemuk lah, besar lah.
Just pulling your leg. But anyway, Mr. Dylan, I'm assuming you, let me guess your age lah. I think you said 80s just now. Are you 81, 82?
More or less there.
Yeah.
More or less there.
Okay. Because we I think we're quite the same age. Well, anyway.
Yeah.
Anyway, Mr. Dylan, one of the from the first product talk just now, you talk about food security. What is exactly what is food security?
It's a current issue that everyone is well concerned. That globally, sekarang ni we are facing a lot of this food security issue.
Okay. What is
and Malaysia is no exemption. Malaysia is no exemption because there's a growing threat of the rising food insecurity globally. Kalau kita tengok, because of you know the production. Of the foods are not to the level of what it used to be, you know. And as some of the crisis, some of the things that I could have gone and track is almost, I think I came across an article that almost 700 million people faced hunger in 2022.
Goodness. Where is that?
700 people, which globally. I came across.
Globally. Wow.
Yes.
I see. May I ask? Oh, sorry to cut you. Please continue.
So, even Malaysia is also is in that what you call part of this. Okay. And like some of the issues that kita just came through across, like the chicken, eggs. You know.
Yeah.
This is part of it because we don't have that sustainable. We don't have that. Kind of you know stock, why we don't do it and everything, because kita tak produce
not enough,
you know, we always bang on, and there's a lot of shortages and everything. Below shortages there are a lot of, you know, people like to produce half cooked things, you see.
I see.
So this is where the chemicals, see, sometimes like us, maybe the kids grew in 80s, we know how our parents, you know, we know how the nutrients there and everything, but now we don't find it.
Okay.
So how can one solve these food security issues? So the the country, like for instance, I can take Malaysia. Mm-hmm. Malaysia should focus on the household financial ability, mm-hmm. how they can, you know, have this nutritional status mm-hmm. and resilience. Mm-hmm. So, and they put a focus solely on national menu production. Mm-hmm. So as a sustainability, as own initiative, so like an individual, mm-hmm. how can we produce on our own? Mm. So actually, a lot of abundance houses are there in the country. Mungkin, mm. you know, youngsters can come up, can learn, and, you know, do their own agriculture, mm. which is basically based on the latest technologies, mm-hmm. which don't use bad chemicals, mm-hmm. you know, healthy food for the next generation.
I see. That is food security.
I see.
Yeah.
So I think not just that. Actually, we have quite numerous numbers of program fully packed for these 2 days in here in Gates 2024. I think what do you wanna? I'm gonna give you a chance to or somehow to promote this event. Why should we go to our listeners? Mm.
Actually, this event, as I just mentioned earlier, this mm-hmm. is also part of any other agriculture event taking place in the country.
Yeah. Okay.
But perhaps what can differentiate between us and them is that ours is basically focusing on the conference where mm-hmm. we will touch on the latest when your current issues that is faced by the Awangkata farmers, mm-hmm. agriculture sectors and everything. So mm-hmm. as you can see, a lot of new technologies, a lot of new innovation dapun arrive globally.
Correct.
Tapi whether we are ready to capture it, whether we are ready to learn, get the knowledge untuk make use of it and untuk produce, mm-hmm. you know, a very sustainable food for the future, mm-hmm. kita yang perlu soalan kita. So, wow. I mean, we ask the question dekat kita lah.
Mm, yeah.
So, speakers yang kita bawa ini will discuss in depth the issues that is being faced oleh farmers. Mm-hmm. Dan mereka juga akan memberi beberapa solution. Mm. Dan all the exhibitors akan bawa teknologi terbaru. Sebab event ini bukan hanya cover the technology sector. Mm-hmm. The technology sekarang diguna pakai oleh semua sektor perikanan, peladangan, livestock, you know, poultry, semua pakai teknologi. So that's why ours, you can see the name Global Agritech.
Correct.
So the tech in it, yes. is actually focusing all the 360 degree of the sectors.
Wow, the technology sector, of course.
So like Sabah especially. We believe that Sabah State has a lot of potential.
Yes,
has a lot of course, Kementerian and the Sabah State itself mm-hmm. has a lot of, plan untuk farmers, untuk in-house private sectors, untuk explore global market. Mm-hmm. So this open up a door lah sebagai satu pembukaan mm-hmm. untuk mereka mengenali lebih mendekati. Di topik-topik yang akan dibawa oleh speaker yang berbawa pengalaman and but most importantly interaction dengan international delegate itu yang sangat penting. Awesome. Walaupun kita jemput international delegate ke Sabah untuk mengenali Sabah tapi peluang untuk kita juga untuk mendekati mereka dan mendengar ataupun mendapat nasihat daripada mereka juga.
Yes, that's the biggest. I think the biggest
benefit is coming from it.
Yeah, coming from it. Well, thank you so much, Mr. Dylan. We should be talking more for many episodes before you guys coming down. But I wish.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. I think I wish prior to the event, if you will be coming down, probably 4-3 weeks, probably prior to it, we can do a face to face in a studio with us, Kinabalu Podcast.
We will do, inshallah, we will do.
Yes.
Nice. Awesome.
All right, man. Thank you so much, Mr. Dylan.
Thank you so much. And I just want to tell that this event is brought by My Events International, supported by Kementerian Pertanian, Perikanan, dan Industri Makanan Sabah.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Okay. A little bit cut off there.
Digital partner, Malaysia Digital Economy Corporation.
Okay.
And that. Dan okay. supported by Pada Sama Sabah, Ekoyap Farm dan juga Sabah Tourism Board.
Nice.
Dan our invest exclusive invest partner Invest Sabah dan of course you guys. Yeah. Thank you so much. Kinabalu yes. Podcast, you guys are really wonderful.
Thank you so much. We want to, of course, share this knowledge to our, you know, our locals here for sure.
Yes, man.
Because we grew up with farmers, we grew up with this environment, and I think they should really take a chance to come and learn more and take more knowledge there for sure.
That is true.
Alright, podcast ini dibawakan kepada anda oleh the 3rd Global AgriTech Summit 2024. Come, datang bersama-sama bersama kami di 8 dan 9 Oktober ini di Sabah International Convention Center, SICC, untuk amazing punya event dalam selebrasi kita bersama dengan future ataupun masa depan agriculture. Di sini ni, Global AgriTech ni, Gates ni 2024 ni, Ken, kita akan memberikan anda all scopes of angle to upscale opportunities in the future of making agriculture more profitable, more productive, more sustainable to the era of modernization sesuai mengikut cabang bidang peradangan anda.
Ya, di sepanjang dua hari ini kita akan dihujani dengan conference Q&A sessions, bual bicara daripada panel-panel terkemuka negara khas buat hadirin dan hadirat yang hadir. Jangan lupa juga kita ada booth-booth yang padat dengan pameran serta knowledge yang tersedia oleh para peserta pameran di Gates 2024. Selain itu juga kita ada showcase, demonstrasi dan peluang meluaskan networking kita antara satu pengusaha ke pengusaha yang lain. Jadi jangan lepaskan peluang ini dengan mendaftar penyertaan anda sekarang.
Now,
untuk mengetahui lebih lanjut lagi, terus saja layari www.globalagritechsummit.com sekarang, atau email mereka di info@globalagritechsummit.com. Dan jangan lupa anda juga boleh direct WhatsApp mereka di 012-335-5067.
Wow. Jadi sampai di sini saja. Saya Ricardo.
Saya Kenny.
Kami dari Kinabalu Podcast, the number one podcast in Sabah. Ciao, ciao, ciao.
Ciao, bella, ciao.
Hi everyone, I'm Boss James. You are listening to Kinabalu Podcast, number one podcast in Sabah.